2019 WFTDA International Championships. Yes, the crowd is hyped up. It's the last game of day one. That's game number six, if you're counting at home. This is Gotham Girls Roller Derby up against Montreal. That's right, the hometown heroes, Montreal, Gotham Girls out of New York. They haven't skated yet. Montreal skated in game two, taking the win against Dos por Cuatro. I am Def Nella, joined by October Revolution. We are so happy that you are with us right now. This is incredible. We have 3 minutes to go, and we're going to run through those rosters.
Yeah, so first we're going to talk about Montreal Roller Derby. They are ranked number 9, and their roster is 008, Lowrider, number 1017, Bigly Smalls, number 123, Miracle Wits, number 13, Alcatraz, number 1773, Magnum PEI, number 18, Badger, number 19, Free Shabakadu, number 204, Scar2B2, number 289, Cheese Grater, number 44, Paper Cut, number 59, Kaio Kenzie, number 62, Ai, number 66, Falcon Punch, number 911, Nana Bisturi, number 999, Katie Kaboom, and number 9999, Mange-moi El Cou, and their coaches and bench staff are Arkham Fury, No Picks Please, D-Ray, Clone Media, and Patricide.
And for Gotham Girls Roller Derby, number 02, Pinky Swears, number 111, Cherry Napalm, number 1680, Daryl, number 17, Fast and Loose, number 1978, Space Invader, number 213, Spork Chop, number 221, Yeti or Not, Here I Come, number 23, Livy Smalls, number 314, Caffeined, number 365, The Smacktivist, number 4, Violet Knockout, number 41, Roxy Dallas, number 4500, Benita Applebaum, number 553, Beauty Andy Beast, and number 56, Kate Sarah Sarah.
Teams have met 6 times before. 5 of those, Gotham has won.
Yeah.
The last time they met, Gotham won 201 to 111. And
oh my gosh.
Fun fact, for both of these teams to keep their ranking points, you have to pretty much have that exact score.
Interesting.
Yeah,
okay.
So it's, I checked out the WFTDA stats at WFTDA.com. And yeah, it was 207. It's, for Gotham to keep theirs, it's 207 to 113. And for Montreal to keep theirs, it's 216 to 104, so pretty much they'd need to repeat it. But I don't think either team wants to repeat exactly at the same time. Both of them want to do better.
You talk about their constant playing against one another. That has to do with the geographics, of course.
We're only about 6 hours from New York City here,
so
in Montreal.
Very friendly in that perspective, and lots of tournament play between these two as well. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how Montreal coming in very prepared for that Dos por Cuatro game this morning.
Yes.
Knowing their opponent in and out, and I know that they have talked about how much they practice. That's what you do at this level, of course. But really, this is going to be a big test.
Yeah.
Have they practiced enough for this Gotham team?
I think the whole story of today has been what teams have watched footage, studied footage, and then used that footage to inform their game on the track. Montreal absolutely did that for Dos por Cuatro. They came in there and they knew exactly what they needed to do. They needed to keep those blockers far apart from each other, no friends. They needed to keep the lines open for their jammers, who love to play the tape, and they needed to put enough points on the board that Dos por Cuatro couldn't adjust to catch back up, and that's exactly what they did. They had a big, they kept 12, you know, 12 jams in a row in the beginning. They put enough cushion there that even when Dos por Cuatro figured out how to counter, they just didn't have the time or space to do it.
It was too late, and as we say that, the whistle blows on this game six. Kate Sarah Sarah with a star for Gotham in black, and Scar2 beat you out with a star for Montreal. Scar2 beat you, have to make note, had a penalty-free first game in a game with a total of how many penalties?
I think it was 41 and 37, so is that 78? I don't know, a lot. Over 70.
Yes, so that is something of note. Very effective jammer. And now we're going Scar2 beat you, trying to work her way around that Gotham line, holding things down very close to the jammer line.
Yeah, well, we haven't moved out of the straightaway quite yet, although we do have some people over the pivot line, not everybody. And both these teams are figuring out each other's defense, and no one has really broken away quite yet.
Although Violet Knockout able to knock Scar2 beat you out on the straightaway, and that opens things up for Kate Sarah Sarah to collect lead jammer. And incredible work on the inside line there by Kate Sarasara. The pack right into turn four. Things seem to be speeding up and standing still at the same time. Scartu Bichu is now out of the pack on her initial, and Kate will call it.
It was about almost, it was like a minute and 30 jam. 4 points on the board for Gotham, zero for Montreal. We have 28 minutes and 30 seconds about left in the half. And now we're going to line up and do it again.
I think this will be a very heavily defensive game. I mean, we saw that from Montreal earlier today. Gotham, of course, playing for the first time today, earning that seeding in the tournament. We will have Falcon Punch out there.
Falcon Punch was expelled from the first game earlier today for, I think it was an egregious black box, but is back in the game. Lead now, though, goes to the Smacktivist.
Activist coming around for some more. Oh, they're able to just skirt by, but not quite. The Montreal wall locking in. Meanwhile, Falcon Punch now out on her initial, already coming back to collect those points. Wow, the speed on Falcon Punch there, able to close that gap, keeping it, no, not quite scoreless. We see 3 points on the board for Gotham, making it 7-0 so far, heading into jam three.
Smacktiv is back in postseason play after playing with Ohio, now on Gotham in New York, and they've always been kind of a fun jammer to watch, so I'm excited to see them back on the track and jamming again.
And with the star this jam, we have Miracle Whips, definitely a powerhouse for Montreal, up against Space Invader for Gotham Roller Girls. Space, always a fun jammer to watch as well, but the crowd is loving it. You can probably hear it through the microphone here. Miracle Whips grabbing the lead for Montreal. And just laser focus right now, heading into the straightaway. Pack barely moving. We're seeing a lot of that. And a big knock to the outside there onto turn one. So a drag back by Violet Knockout, while Space Invader is now clear on her initial.
I was waiting to see what was going to happen. And what happened was the jam ended. That's going to be, I saw three go up, so we'll see what happens.
And that is the first points for Montreal.
Here in the replay, we have Miracle Whips on the outside. Like I said, love the tape. You don't leave space on that line if you don't want a Montreal jammer to be there.
Yeah.
I was saying earlier today, I'll say it again, you have to put a full body on the line, which makes it harder to kind of do that zone defense, right? Because you have to come off those lines in order to block the different lanes. But if you come off the line, Montreal just zoops right by you.
And into jam for the pack. Moving now a lot quicker into turn one. Kate Sarasara trying to fight through Kayo Kenzie. We weren't sure if she was going to be out here. She was injured in the first game a little bit. They weren't sure, but she is now captaining and, of course, jamming up against just a solid Gotham wall that's not budging into turn two. Kate Sarasara getting caught up there on some Montreal blockers using a very effective tripod brace at the back.
Yeah, Kayo Kenzie tweeting earlier today that she has a blood clot in her leg and it was inflamed, so it's not an injury as much as it's a thing she's dealing with
yes,
this weekend.
You're right.
Yeah.
And Kate Sarasara being recycled back, having a difficult go at the back of the back. Montreal's blockers basically keeping her in the back of the back. The crowd going absolutely wild as Gotham's able to draw back Kayo Kenzie. And Kayo draws a cut track, so she is going to the penalty box, meaning Kate Sarasara still can navigate a way out of this, but we're now a minute into this jam. Kate Sarasara unable to get past turn one. That is how locked down the Montreal defense is.
And this is the first power jam of the game, and Montreal is giving it up to Gotham.
And Kate Sarasara's
lead.
Yeah, cleared out there on turn two. The crowd is a really fun energy right now.
Yeah, that's a minute and 27 seconds to lead in this jam.
Oh, look at that. Straight out of the penalty box. That Montreal blocker just staring down Kate Sarasara. That's cheese grater.
Everybody's out of the... Oh, not everybody. Most people are out of the box. Oh, I think everyone. We have a bad angle on the penalty box.
Oh.
But I think it's empty right now.
Kate Sarasara is still having difficulty trying to get into this scoring trip through the pack. Kayo Kenzie has been released and is trying to work her way through to score some points. We'll see where that lands. It's three extra there for Gotham. And I believe Montreal was shut out, rather.
It's going to be 10 points for Gotham total, 3 for Montreal. We have just under 24 minutes left in the half. Here in the replay, we're looking at that when Kate Sarasara was able to get out. Again, that's a like a real sweet spot for jammers because the track gets just real wide in the turn, and you can both cut in and get through, or you can kind of hug out and get through, and it's harder for blockers to cover that space.
And we're into jam 5, Falcon Punch with the star for Montreal, but the Smacktivist getting the smackdown there, able to grab lead jammer status. Now they're at the back of the Montreal pack, trying to work their way through the seams, not quite. Meanwhile, Falcon Punch up near turn 2, and is released. The crowd is going nuts. My apologies if I end up yelling a little bit.
It's very loud.
It is loud. It is energetic. Falcon Punch feeling really good about at least stopping a full scoring opportunity there. Gotham picks up 2 additional points, bringing the total 12-3. We have less than 23 minutes left in the half.
It's a good time to remind you that the 2000... Oh, is here? We're going to watch the replay first, and then I will remind you. There's a Smacktivist finding the wide open inside lane there. And the flying block that does not connect. When those work, though, they're so satisfying, but they so rarely do.
Yes, and this champs has already proven that today. Many a flying attempts not quite landing. And Kate Sarasara with the star once more for God. Badger out in front for Montreal. The crowd is going absolutely nuts. Oh, my goodness. A track cut penalty for Kate Sarasara means Badger not only has lead, but power jam happening right now. Picked up 4 points. The crowd is going nuts.
More play than she normally would have gotten in the first game today because Falcon Punch fouled out. So she's probably a little warmer and more in the groove than she might be otherwise. And here she's going.
Well, and also Badger's been playing with the pack of vengeance. Another scoring trip through the pack. This is absolutely nuts in here right now. We're at 12 points already. Kate Sarasara just released from the penalty box. Now coming towards the back, leading into turn 3. The pack is sort of recycled back as far as possible. Both back, everyone up to full strength now. That was the other thing. Badger had the advantage for a while where Gotham was at a pack disadvantage. Kate Sarasara finding a hard time up against this Montreal wall.
Montreal just not letting an inch for Kate Sarasara. Really, it's a very different Montreal than we saw this morning. So they definitely are playing against tape. And then Gotham, of course, always playing this kind of beautiful defense where they slow and stop those jammers down and doing it again.
Alcatraz has also been a formidable blocker for Montreal. And the hometown crowd is pleased with that effort. A 14-point jam total. I'm not sure we got to see many of those earlier for Montreal. So
one, maybe. And this is
huge.
17 points now for Montreal. It's a lead change. 12 for Gotham. Gotham's calling a timeout immediately on that. They're going to take a second to regroup. We're at 20:57, and it's a good time for me to tell you that the 2019... Oh, sorry. Every time I want to talk to you about a sponsor that we have a replay, there's a... That's a lucky line for jammers right now. The inside... Everyone's leaving the inside aisle open if you can get there first.
And this sport court must... There must be some slick spots because there's certain points on this track that have been particularly nasty for blockers as well, trying to stay upright.
All right, so the 2019 Wftda Championships are brought to you by the popular Riedel Solaris. The performance you demand, the comfort you've been missing. Check out Solaris. Here we're going to look at another replay. This is Kate Sarasara being knocked around on the outside, trying to stay in bounds.
And does so. Notice that, the hips right into the middle as we talk about. If you want to keep your momentum forward, you got to make sure that your projection and your trajectory is in there. We're going into jam seven, at the end of this timeout. We have a little less than 21 minutes left in the half. Still a meaty half left.
It feels like so much roller derby has happened, and yet there's so much more.
And we have the Smacktivist out for Gotham. Miracle Whips with the star for Montreal. And the Smacktivist picks up Lee Jammer. So there's a very mixed crowd right now. We have a loud support for Montreal, loud support for Gotham. Smacktivist
getting worked a little bit now, coming back. Meanwhile, Miracle Whip's out on the initial, already coming to collect some points. She did not pick up any. Smacktivist kept down to 1 point on that jam. So Montreal still with the lead, 17 to Gotham's 13. Another look now at Smacktivist trying that apex jump, not quite getting the bump out there by Montreal.
Yeah, you know, they thought they could kind of point their body where they wanted to go and take a jump, but Montreal did a good job of kind of following to and past the line without being out of bounds and doing so. And that was good and productive.
And heading into Jam 8, Beauty and the Beast for the first time with a star for Gotham. Scar to beat you out for Montreal. Scar to beat you getting caught up there on turn one. I'm not laughing at anyone's performance here. This is serious business, but you just see bodies suddenly off on the other side
of
the track.
They kind of like pop out. You know, you don't see the hit, just suddenly there's a human that like pops out and is out of bounds.
A little popcorn. So meanwhile, Scar 2 now still trying to navigate the Gotham wall at the back of the pack. The pack splitting into turn two. Beauty and the Beast awarded lead jammer status, now coming around to collect those points. Scar 2 has taken the helmet cover off. Not sure if she's looking for a pass or simply a distraction, but this pack is now locked down into turn one.
Yeah, Scar 2 beat you is in the sad place. I don't have another way to say it.
All these jammers are entering that sad place from time to time. There is a penalty assessed to Montreal blocker Cheese Grater, so that frees up Beauty and the Beast picking up 4 points, and now we're currently tied, but it'll likely change by the end of this jam. Oh, Beauty and the Beast coming in really quickly, finding those arm seams there.
Yeah, deciding that it was going to be easier to go through the middle than on either end, and almost did it, but Montreal doing a good job of kind of putting a last line of defense up in the front and regrouping here.
This Montreal three wall is just causing a grind. I'm talking about them, but then I look at Gotham's line right now, and they're keeping things interesting as well. The crowd going absolutely nuts right now for this one-on-one blocking. Oh, my goodness.
It was Lowrider held Beauty and the Beast for like a quarter of a track, just with her chest, basically, just kind of pushing backwards, slowing her down. You know, Beauty and the Beast gets 8 on that jam. 21 now for Gotham. We have a lead change back the other way. 17 for Montreal. 17 minutes, 37 seconds left in this game. Not game, half. This is the first half of the game.
And we have Falcon Punch out there with the star for Montreal and Space Invader for Gotham. And it is Falcon Punch who is out first, picks up lead. Space Invader now trying to laterally move, gets by on the inside, little apex hop, but Falcon Punch already coming to collect some points. The pack is speeding up big time. Oh my goodness! Falcon Punch able to stay in bounds with Violet Knockout, causing some trouble, but not quite enough to disrupt, and Montreal picks up 4 points for their efforts there. We are now tied 21 apiece.
Here you go in the replay. You can see Falcon Punch just basically running Gotham for that one, and that's the first lead for Falcon Punch in the game so far.
I just love that. Oh yeah, I'll just stand up and
yeah, you said the game is tied, right?
Yes, it
okay.
is. I'm just making sure.
Yeah,
I know. For everyone following at home, the game is tied. Cade Sarasara with the star for Gotham. Kaio Kensi, your captain, trying to hold things down for Montreal, but Cade Sarasara freed up quickly, but wow, Kaio is just like lightning behind Cade. They're both entering the pack essentially at the same time. This is, wow, Kaio able to keep 1 point there for Montreal. Gotham with a full four.
25 to 22 now, 16 left in the half. And this floor was laid with help from a gaff gun. Get your teams today at gaffgun.com.
Wow.
Here in the replay,
I've seen some magic today. Look at that.
I want those points. I get those points. Now we call it off.
And just skating by on that outside foot. Incredible. We have Smack
Smacktivist out there with the star for Gotham. Miracle whips for Montreal, and Smacktivist out again with lead. Really good showing by Smacktivist so far.
100% lead percentage for Smacktivist on this game so
far. Look at that speed, not wasting any time getting by Malge. Able to pick up 4 points for Gotham.
Smacktivist normally only has 56% lead percentage for Gotham, so real good game as Smacktivist having tonight in front of this crowd.
There was a big attempt there to try to slow Smack down, but not enough. Picks up another 4 points. Montreal getting a little bit stuck right now, trying to spot where that jammer is. Oh, I see. Miracle Whip's a star in hand, hence why a little bit tricky to spot it. Getting stuck in that sad place, trying to get by, but Gotham just reforming far too quickly. Where the pack right now still kind of in that straightaway into turn one.
Yeah, we're kind of seeing that traditional brace three wall, bridges in the middle.
Bridges in the middle,
bridges
yes.
In the middle. Everybody's stuck. We're sitting in turn one. You know, roller derby.
Roller derby, we know. I know, especially after all day seeing zone defense and a more fluid style of play, but incredible work there by the Smacktivist to free themselves out of the pack, and the crowd is going nuts. A star pass now to LK Traz for Montreal. We'll see what happens here. A mega jam, though, for Gotham.
And Montreal was not in a position to do many star passes in their game this morning. Was unsure what their star pass strategy was going to be, and it looks like they have one. Here it is.
Look at this. Essentially almost a doubled score right now.
Yeah.
Gotham 41, Montreal 22. Another look. Boom! Smacktivist bringing it up against Mange. And the thing is, you can't mess around when you come up against Mange. Like, you need to commit, and that is commitment.
To knock Mange off her skates like that, that might be why your name would be the Smacktivist.
Wow. All right. So, Beauty Andy Beast with a star for Gotham. Badger from Montreal. Badger, of course, having that massive multi-scoring jam earlier. 14 points for Montreal. So I bet you they're obviously trying to do that again to try to lessen that lead picked up in the last jam. It is. Who's out in front? Oh, it is Badger, and the crowd is going nuts right now. This Montreal energy is next level on a Friday night. Badger now coming around to collect points, but gets the bump out on turn two.
Badger 2 for 2 on leads. And let's see what points look like. This is a 0-0 jam.
She's hoping for at least a few and gets one.
No,
gets
two.
Gets two. And here we have a look again at that moment. Wow. Beauty Andy Beast doing some great surfing, but unfortunately that outside lane wide open for Montreal to capitalize.
And we're looking at a 41-24 score with 12:23 left. And don't forget Superfit Hero apparel designed for roller derby, tough enough for any workout. Team Warner's sponsorship available at superfithero.com.
And during those messages, Space Invader has picked up lead in Jam 13 while Falcon Punch wears the star for Montreal. Oh, and ends up taking a spill there in turn one. Space Invader already around for 4 points. This pack is really locking itself down. Falcon Punch is now out on her initial. And Space Invader hoping to pick up even more. Wow, a wide open inside lane. Some deadly offense provided there by Gotham.
And the score's gonna be, I think it's 7 points for Gotham. 0 for Montreal, gonna be 48-24. So Montreal been held low in score or scoreless for since the tie pretty much. It was a 21-21 tie. Now it's 49-24. Here in the replay, we're looking at Space Invader calling off that jam, picking up those points. I love a jammer that counts points, and it's very clear that Gotham's jammers are counting their points.
Yep.
And call off that jam when they've decided they've gotten any point that they can get before allowing the other jammer to get it.
We have an official timeout, and I know that we'll have some messages to share with you, but we will also run through the officials' rosters at some point. We like to leave you hanging on that.
I'm going to read them right now.
Oh, perfect. Let's do it.
Our skating officials in this game are Killabrew, Ogre, Shebra, Base Invader, Izzy Demented, Landon Flat, Inkabong, and our non-skating officials are John Brawls, Le Corbusier,
I don't know if I said that right. Heads will roll. John Brawl. I just said John Brawls. Joe Care. The Kraken. A Guru. Rex Blacker. Linz and Needles. Misty Moan. And Amy Farrell Fowler.
And a shout out to our alt ref as well, Kerr's So Good, because he will be bringing us all the information when there is an official review. I know that throughout the day it's been a little on and off because that's how life is, right?
You know, it's Friday.
Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So we'll try to bring you as much information as possible. You are listening to Death Nella and October Revolution, produced by the wonderful Chloroform Cupcakes.
So this is an official review by Montreal.
Ah,
the ref just spoke into a microphone and we didn't hear it. So we'll let you know when the alt ref comes over and tells us what's going on. But I can't understate quite what the energy is like in this room right now. Mm-hmm. It is very full. You know, this Champs is always a tournament with lots and lots of people at it, but this is a home team game.
Which, let's just remind everyone, that doesn't always happen at Champs.
No.
Because if this is your first time watching Champs, it doesn't work that a team who makes it gets to host it. It's all done well in advance, and it
yes.
just so happens Montreal earned that spot.
They went to Seattle. They won their spot here. They came here. They won this morning to get their spot in this game. And now they're here and hoping to put on a show. And their fans are here. It's actually really interesting. I noticed before when I was walking through the crowd, the Montreal fans build pyramids of empty beer cans.
Yeah, it's a very Canadian thing.
It's like
for
a
sure.
thing that they do, and it's
yeah.
amazing.
Yeah, a little pyramid, if you will. So the winner of this game is playing for a semifinal spot. That's why there's a lot on the line, and I'm just trying to make sure we know where what's going on. They'll be playing a VRDL tomorrow, 6 p.m. Eastern. That's game 9. So something to consider and a reminder of what's at stake here. There's 11 minutes, 15 seconds left in the first half. We are right now in the midst of an official review.
It's a good time to tell you the WFTDA championships are proudly sponsored by Radar Wheels. Radar Halo, number one wheel in Derby. So check out Radar Wheels.
And it looks like Kerr's So Good is bringing some information over to producer Cupcakes. So we'll have that for you in just a moment. And we are going to, looks like we're proceeding with both jammers on the line. Gotham had picked up 8 points in that last jam. So the total right now, Gotham 49, Montreal 24. And it looks like Montreal has lost their official review. We'll have those details in just a moment as Scar2BeatYou picks up lead. The crowd having that energy again after a bit of a lull. Kate Sarasara, though, not even a half lap behind, just speeding by. What? No problem for Kate Sarasara, although gets the spill out on the outside line there. Scar2BeatYou, same thing. Both jammers now being recycled back to turn two. There really is a slick spot in there, Tober.
So just so you know, that official review, Montreal was looking for a jammer penalty, but it was two jams ago.
Oh.
That's too long. So they lost their official review, and they could not even evaluate whether or
okay.
not that penalty happened.
A note for all the coaches watching. You must call that official review.
I think it's one jam you
right,
get.
Yeah, right after the action. All right, into jam 14. The pack essentially at a standstill now between turns 2 and 3. Kate Sarasara, after just simply flying by blockers, now getting held up. But oh, as I say that, able to clear. Sometimes when you take a moment to reset, like Kate just did, you're able to find that lane. But Scar2BeatYou calling it off after picking up 4 points there for Montreal.
Yeah, and that skill of being able to see where your body fits and then accelerating at just the right moment to get through it before it closes, that's one of my favorite jammer skills. And it's great when it works like that. You can just see it. This is a different pass. That's Scar2BeatYou picking up lead at the beginning of that on the outside. And that's just what Montreal jammers do.
And look at that tight pack at the jammer line. Everyone jockeying for some kind of position. So we are seeing a bit of that zone style in here, but as I speak, the Smactivist picks up lead. Smactivist having a very solid showing this first half, coming up against a pretty solid Montreal line, but Miracle Whip's getting whipped around a little bit there by that Gotham wall as well, and sent to the penalty box. So it is a power jam right now for the Smacktivist.
Smacktivist still in 100% lead, hasn't gone to the box yet, and has scored 22 points, the most on Gotham.
This is a big one if they're able to capitalize. The Smacktivist working their way laterally, trying to get a t-shirt whip there off of one of the Gotham blockers, but Montreal just locking down. Now a three wall. Mange is involved. We have Free Shivakadu. And Miracle Whips able to use all that distraction to get by on her initial, forcing the call off. So not really too much gain. Of course, Gotham still in the lead right now. Picked 4 points for a total of 57 to Montreal's 28. We have 8 minutes left in the first half.
Smacktivist is such a precise jammer. They get lead, score points, and never ever come close to allowing points in the other team. They know exactly where on the track the other jammer is, calls it off, doesn't waste time. No fuss, no muss.
And you can't understate that when you're in a pressure situation like champs. Now into jam 15, we have Beauty, Andy, Beast, Kayo, Kenzie with the stars for their teams. Kayo up in the front of the pack. Montreal sitting further behind, and the crowd is lit up as Kayo gets lead jammer status right in front of that main group of spectators. Already coming back to collect some points, and this time it is Gotham with the cut track and a power jam situation for Montreal.
Yeah, so now Montreal gets a chance to try and cut this differential up, and Gotham doesn't want that to happen, so they've been able to stop this pack basically in its tracks. We're pretty much stuck in turn three, and it's scrummy in there.
That's a really great way to put it. It does look like a scrum in a lot of ways, because we're not seeing right now any as much active offense. Oh, as I say that, number 1-3 Alcatraz helps try to peel off a blocker, but instead Kayo's deciding, I'm going to freeze the Gotham jammer in the box so I can get a power start.
And the beautiful thing that Gotham was doing right there was they were using some of Montreal's blockers to slow down Kayo Kenzie, and it gave some opportunity for the waterfall or to stop and slow or pause in the front. And you'll see that happen a lot this weekend, where as a jammer will start to get out, they'll use they'll get their blockers in the way so they can't go through them, and then they will send two people up front to slow them down. And here, right there.
Into the next jam already. Falcon Punch able to grab that power start lead right away, already collecting points, while Beauty Andy Beast is trying to work on her initial pass, getting hung up on that Montreal wall. Wow, a nice t-shirt whip attempt there by Falcon Punch, unable to land past the pack, but Beauty Andy Beast is just working laterally. Mange catching her. Oh!
Mange thought she had her. She did not.
There you go.
She did not. She's like, oh, you're over the line. And Beauty and the Beast is like, I am all the way on this side of the tape and the rope, and I am now out. And that's going to force the call off. 4 more points for Montreal, 36 to 57, with 5.5 minutes left in this half.
You know, the interesting thing with Derby is that there's so many ways to cross-train for this sport in so many ways, but you really want to try to do things that open you up to more body awareness. Because even at this champs level, we've seen it all day, Tober, just people thinking that they're at the line.
Yeah,
right?
And they're not.
And because you have to have next-level awareness. Anyhow, Space Invader with the star for Gotham. Badger out there for Montreal. Badger, of course, having that perfect lead percentage so far. We'll see how this one plays out.
You know, and just go back to that a little bit. Mange is used to being one of the most powerful blockers on the floor, right? So she knows when she hits somebody or how she hits them. You also saw Mange was playing offense in that jam and wasn't really being as effective as you would expect Mange to be, because Gotham was prepared for it and is countering it. And I think that, you know, you make those mistakes when you're used to always knocking that jammer out. Lead went to Space Invader on that jam.
And already coming to pick up points into turn one. I mean, you couldn't ask for a better setup for the spectators here on the track level. They are right in front of turns one and two, and that's where all the action is happening at this level. Everyone hunkering down. We do have that three brace wall of Gotham making things so difficult for Alcatraz. I do believe there had been a star pass. No? Yes, there is a star pass.
Yep, I see it now.
Yep.
Looks like there is a high block called on the outside. Not quite sure who it is. Looks like a Montreal skater is going to go take a seat in the penalty box. Space Invader free for four.
And we'll get to the penalty box rows in just a moment, because there actually is some as we head into the final 4 minutes of the first half. Space Invader picking up another 4 points. This is a big deal for Gotham right now. Alcatraz, or rather the Montreal blocker has been released from the back. That was Badger. And a official star pass. Alcatraz out on her initial. There's a lot going on in that moment. Trying to keep track of everything. So when I mentioned penalties, I was looking at the board. That is six penalties for Cheese Grater of Montreal. Six. In the first half.
In the first half, yeah, that's... Yo. Here we go in the replay. We're looking at Space Invader getting knocked around inside the pack, but able to find a line out. That was in that last jam. S1 Lifer Visor Helmet, next level protection.
I'd like an alternate name for Space Creator, because Ooh. That's what she just did there.
That was a good pun.
Open it all up. Open it all up. And we have the Smactivist out with the star. Already has lead. Coming back to collect some points in to turn one. It is Jam 19. Miracle Whips with the star for Montreal. Able to get by a little faster than she's been able to in some of the previous jams, because the Gotham defense was so locked on her style there. Four more points. Gotham now really stretching that.
Reliable jammer in the Smactivist. Four more points, 73 to 36. They're going to keep their 100% lead. And I'm not sure what's going on in the replay. Up there it is.
What you're seeing is beautiful roller derby.
Yes. Smactivist loves the inside line there. You don't want to open up that lane. The Smactivist will just take it, and they will take the points too.
And when I say things like beautiful derby, I mean from both of these teams. It is such a pleasure to watch the passion on this track right now. Scar to beat you for Montreal and Kate Sarasara. We've seen this matchup pretty consistently. Oh, and Scar. And is already coming back to collect points while Kate Sarasara is getting hung up there on number 1-3. That's Alcatraz. I've said her name so many times now because she's that blocker that's always in your way.
It's great to beat you. Still penalty-less on the whole day.
Wow. As we're talking about penalties and people collecting pretty dangerous numbers there, Scarty playing quite cleanly and is very effective in grabbing those 4 points and calling off the jam there. Just edging a little bit. We have less than a minute to go on the game clock. Let's take another look at Scar to beat you.
Pushing a blocker out in front to help. Like, hey, go here, make some space for me.
Yes.
And then putting her body in the space. And Kate Sarasara, though, has been struggling, is one of the only Gotham jammers with a negative differential in the game, and also has picked up a couple jammer penalties.
That O was for a massive apex jump. The Smactivist again out on the line. Falcon Punch with the star and already coming back to collect. So both jammers now engaging, but Montreal will remain scoreless on that jam.
Smactivist picks up two.
Wow.
Still has 100% lead percentage, I believe, is penalty-less as well. And we're going to go into an official timeout here in the replay.
And there we see that moment. Smactivist capitalizing, grabbing the apex jump right there.
If I'm Montreal, the second I see Smactivist on the line, I would just put somebody on the inside. I'd be like, you're on the inside now. Lock it down.
Yes. Yes. Wow. This first half has been a journey in terms of just the defensive-minded gameplay.
It's somehow fast and long at the same time.
I kind of like it.
You should check out derbywithoutborders.org to see how you can help support the growth of roller derby around the world, and check out the Derby Without Borders game tomorrow.
Yes. Looking forward to this big time.
Yeah, I think it's at 11?
It's at 11:30.
11:30.
Oh, perfect. That's Scar2BeatYou's face. She's rocking her Team Canada colors in that poster. I did notice that earlier on.
So in this timeout, we're 12 seconds in the period, 75 to 40. Timeout is just about wrap it up. I'm going to go out on a limb and say this will be the last jam in the half.
Let's see about that, October.
All right, so the whistle's blown. Beauty Andy Beast with a star. Kaio Kenzie with, for Montreal. And it is Beauty Andy Beast with a track cut that is massive. Montreal with lead jammers. I can't even hear what I'm saying, so hopefully I'm making sense. The crowd is insane. Already, Kaio Kenzie now coming back to collect points, fighting through that Gotham line. It is just a fluid movement. Kaio getting knocked to the inside, deciding to call off the jam to avoid any points for Gotham. Three more for Montreal, bringing our halftime to 75 for Gotham, 43 for Montreal.
So if I'm Gotham, I'm going into the locker room saying, let's do more of this.
Yes.
They're doing a very good job. I mean, they're not entirely shutting down Montreal, but they definitely are able to keep the differential where they want it, keeping the lead, picking up lead regularly. The Smactivist still at 100%. Space Invader at only a 50% lead, but the differential is still 13. And then, you know, Kate Sera Sera, -8 differential. Beauty Andy Beast, -2 differential. Those are not bad differentials.
No.
So everybody's pretty much doing well.
It's been, like, yeah. I said, it's been a defensive lockdown. It's very exciting to see these effective three walls because we've been seeing zone defense play all day, which, you know, if you're unsure of what I mean by that, the sports desk has been doing a phenomenal job of explaining that, and we can talk about that later. Do want to note, with the penalty story, 13 for Gotham in total, 14 for Montreal. But guess what? Montreal's all really focused in on one player. Half of those, just a little under half, belong to one skater, and that's Cheese Grater. So that might also be an interesting look at how things play out in the second half, because when you look at the totality of penalties, they might be similar, but they're spread out so differently.
And if Cheese Grater falls out or is played less, that penalty count might go down for Montreal, perhaps. Who knows? And then about Montreal, I'm going into the locker room and I'm saying, how do we stop the Smactivist?
Yes. Yes, they need a gameplay for that. They seem to have figured out Kate Sera Sera a bit.
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast, although, you know, those jammer penalties are helping. Mm-hmm. But for Space Invader and absolutely the Smactivist, they just don't have a way to slow or stop them.
All right. Well, we are so glad that you are watching the 2019 Wftda International Championships live from Montreal. I'm Death Nella, joined by October Revolution and our producer, Chloroform Cupcakes, and we will be right back. Don't go anywhere. There's more action coming up. Hello and welcome back. You are watching the 2019 Wftda International Championships live from Montreal, Quebec, Canada. We are so thrilled you're joining us. Game 6, the final game of day one action. And my goodness, it has been a day. We will get through how some of that shaped up in just a moment. You are joining us into the second half of Gotham v. Montreal. Gotham sitting at 75, Montreal 43. I'm Death Nella, joined by October Revolution and our fantastic producer, Chloroform Cupcakes. We're very glad to have such a stellar team here on the broadcast. So, October, break it down in terms of what happened in the first half to get us to this point.
Well, the score right now is 75 to 43, if you can't see. So Montreal beating the differential a little bit if, like, the game were to end and we were to look at rankings. So they're doing a little bit better than predicted in the forecaster. And at one point in the first half, this game was tied. Mm. I would say that Montreal is able to pick up lead and have some control over scoring a little bit more than maybe people would have expected. I think that they thrive on the hometown advantage. Now, some teams don't. Mm. Some teams love it. They seem to really like the loudness and the clapping. It makes them skate faster.
Now, these teams are very familiar with one another. They play each other plenty of times. I'm also just looking at the crowd here because we're not that far. I mean, depends on, I guess, your subjective afar.
6-hour drive.
Yeah, exactly. To New York, where Gotham is based. I see a I Love Yeti
city sign there in the crowd. So lots of fans from both teams, and it has been loud. We saw your comments on hashtag talk to WFTDA, folks saying, you know, it's been a little bit hard to hear the announcers. Well, guess what? It is loud in here.
We're it's hard to hear ourselves.
We're trying our best to balance things out and bring you the best broadcast possible.
Penalties are about balanced. 14 for Montreal, 13 for Gotham, but of course, six of those Montreal penalties are cheese graters, so that's one person kind of with a big burden of the penalty. And when we look at jammer stats, highest scoring jammer right now is going to be the Smacktivists. They have 32 points and 100% lead percentage on seven jams, which is by far the most jams. And the highest scoring jammer on the Montreal side is Badger.
Yeah, Badger with a stellar, massive multi-point
14-point jam.
And we're into the first jam of the second half. Falcon Punch with a star for Montreal. Jammer status, pretty much the crowd just going wild. Beauty Andy Beast with the star for Gotham. And it'll be interesting to see, too, how fast Gotham tries to cut down some of those jams when they're not lead. Are we going to see more star passes? Falcon Punch already picked up 4 points. Now coming back for more. Oh! And is cleared there. There was a bit of a spill, but all legal, all good. Falcon Punch deciding. Montreal now 51, Gotham 75.
Yeah, two of Gotham's jammers have been struggling a little bit. That's Beauty and the Beast and Kate Sarasara. Here we're going to see Falcon Punch in the replay. Skating through.
And it looks like
for 4 points.
Those Gotham skaters got caught up on each other.
Oh, cheese grater now. I see headed off the track and out of the arena. That's going to be 7 for her. So that's a foul out for Montreal. And kind of the elephant in the room for Gotham is that Misty Maven is out in this postseason, the highest scoring jammer in their regular season, and not here today.
And we have Kate Sarasara out for Gotham. Kate not having been quite as effective in the first half. Miracle Whips with the star picks up lead jammer status and is now coming back to collect points. The pack has barely moved into turn one. Whistles are blowing. We'll see where that lands in just a moment. It will be pack advantage for Gotham as one of the Montreal blockers is sent to the penalty box.
Gotham doing a wonderful job of slowing down and stopping. Miracle Whip's going to force the call off. Holds Montreal to 4 on that jam. 55 for them now. 75 for Gotham. This is a 20-point game with 27 minutes left in the half. Here in the replay,
and there
we're seeing Miracle Whips. So here's, if you want to stop Montreal, you gotta, like, don't let them put their toe stop on the tape. The second their toe stop is on the tape, they got you. I keep saying it. I feel like a broken record, but I see it with my eyes.
You do. You do, your eyes behind those stellar sunglasses. I love it. Yeah. It's so chic. It is very bright in this venue.
It is this venue is lit for 70s television, and so it, you know, it is not pretty.
As the kids say, this venue is lit. I mean, this crowd is going absolutely wild. That's my favorite word now, is wild, with excitement. And we have an official timeout at this time.
And it's a good time for us to take some time to talk about Superfit Hero, apparel designed for roller derby, tough enough for any workout. Sign up now for Black Friday deals at superfithero.com. And if you're in the Black Friday deals, you can also get yourself a RollerCon ticket on November 29th. The top placing teams will receive MVP passes to RollerCon 2020. It's July 15th to 19th in Las Vegas, Nevada. Mm. If you haven't been, you should totally go, and you can get your passes starting that same weekend on November 29th.
So hey, that's a good holiday gift.
Your derby Black Friday shopping.
And we will see a matchup this time of Scartu Beat You. And I believe, that is the Smacktivist for Gotham.
Smacktivist has 100% lead percentage on the game. Scartu Beat You has no penalties on the day. Smacktivist keeping their lead percentage pristine. Lead jam.
And Smacktivist coming back. Wow! Incredible momentum. Able to take the outside. No problem. Hop, skip, and a jump. They make it through. Pick up 4 points for Gotham. And this is not where you want to be if you're Montreal. You got to stop any multi-scoring opportunities. Looks like Scartu beat you is now trying to chase down Smacktivist. And the pack is speeding up, which would definitely advantage the jammer in front. So Smacktivist able to pick up one more point for their efforts.
You know, the Smacktivist is such a reliable jammer. You talk about them all the time. But because they can get through like that, it allows Gotham to be able to focus, laser focus, on the other jammer. They don't have to play offense and defense at the same time. They can just play that defense. It stuffs up that other jammer and then increases the Smacktivist point total. So while you'd be like, wow, the Smacktivist is the best jammer ever, maybe true, maybe not. But also it allows those blockers to increase the points as well. They work together really well.
And we have Space Invader with the star. Magnum PEI, oh, has been doing solid blocking this entire game. Does pick up a forearm penalty, so pack advantage to Gotham right now as both jammers still working, jockeying for lead jammer. And it is Space Invader out in front. Well, Falcon Punch gets sent to the penalty box on a high block call going into turn two. Space Invader now working on picking up points. Oh, that was quick work. 4 points. The pack right in front of this big, big crowd in Montreal.
Also behind all the officials that cannot see their number.
It is a little tricky from our vantage point, but it's easy to spot Space Invader coming out for another 4 points. Falcon Punch is waiting to be released from the penalty box. Star in hand. Hopefully
Montreal able to put a tripod up in the front, slow down Space Invader. Gotham ready to catch Falcon Punch and does. Gets pushed up a little bit.
Yeah, but Falcon Punch deciding, I'm not going to get caught up here. I spent too much time away from the track in the penalty box. A big jam there for Space Invader and for Gotham. That's another 4 points total of 12 to none there. Gotham at 96, Montreal 55. And here we see that phenomenal space work by Space Invader. There's just always room. Always room, it seems, in the track that allows no room.
She's able to kind of like wedge her way in between some blockers and kind of take the momentum to get through and make the space.
We're going to see Kate Sarasara grabbing lead very quickly. An incredible confidence. Badger now out as well for Montreal. Kate Sarasara has not been able to have this kind of momentum in the first half as much. And this is more like what we've seen from her in the past. That was a phenomenally fast work. But Badger as well doing a really great effort there, making sure that she's catching up right away. There's that moment on the outside.
I'm going to lose my balance, so you know, I'll just jump instead. Like, the kind of body awareness you need to have to shift your weight like that and decide, like, my feet on the ground are completely not worth it, so I'm just going to throw them in the air so I can put myself the way I need my hips to go.
And the Smacktivist getting, well, a no earned pass, so not lead yet, but they
first time not lead. This is going to be a no lead for the Smacktivist deciding to take the no lead.
It's by choice, of course, but in the sense that there was a no earned pass instead of trying to come back and grab lead, but Smacktivist out for 4 points.
Miracle Whip gets lead and gets the signal from her bench to keep going. It's kind of like they do this thing that looks like when you're getting yarn ready to like ball it, so you're detangling it. Yeah, or like pulling taffy.
Yeah, that's their signal for keep rolling, keep going. Keep rolling. Interesting decision to do that when you have control. I mean, they haven't had much control in the second half. The Miracle Whips trying to capitalize. Right now, Gotham with the net advantage, and I believe they might end with the net advantage. They do. There was a back block penalty assessed as well to
Smacktivist. Did they go into the box? Yes.
Oh.
They're taking a seat in the penalty box on a back block. So it's going to be a power start for Montreal.
Yeah, Kaio Kenzie is going to take the star next. But Gotham did net a win on that jam, 8-5. But let's see the moment here.
This is, I think, when the Smacktivist decides to take the no pass. If they both step out of bounds.
Oh, that's
and
the
then,
no pass.
Yeah, so Smacktivist decides, you know what, I'm going to take this one.
Yep.
Doesn't get lead. And then because of that, Miracle has control of the jam, and that causes this penalty. Of course, we have an official timeout going on, and time for me to tell you that Adam's skate packages give you the most bang for your buck. Check out Adam's skates, hashtag roll your way.
And I see there the NSO is wearing one of the Protect Trans Lives shirts. Folks I know on Twitter have noticed them too. It's all for Trans Awareness Week, so you'll be seeing skaters and officials wearing those in and around championships. Another look at the last jam there. Smacktivist sitting in the penalty box, ready to serve 30 as this next jam. It's jam 7, 22 and a half minutes left in the second half here, Gotham versus Montreal. And it is Kyle Kenzie, the captain for Montreal, trying to, already done a full lap of the track, hasn't earned lead just yet, able to get through working laterally. And so now, Smacktivist standing in the penalty box, they've just been released.
As is the Montreal blocker, that was the advantage that Gotham had on that pass.
And so while Kayo is working on her first scoring trip, the Smacktivists trying to get their initial under their belt. Oh, just some fancy footwork makes it all possible. We'll see where that lands Montreal. 4 points, 64. Gotham has passed the century mark, 108.
21-26 left in the game.
And here we have another look at Smacktivist coming up and just taking that juicy target zone. I mean, that's one of the things you have to remember is if you open up that side, the jammer's going to take advantage
to make a hole on that line because there's no skater on the other side of that line to hit them.
And we see a very squirrely pack off the start here for jam 8. And Space Invader once again. Space Invader almost consistently has been grabbing, not lead this time, a no earned pass. Thank you, Tober.
No problem, the jam ref told me.
The jam ref told me so. I feel like that's a song of some sort. And so it is Falcon Punch who grabs lead jammer's end. It's been a fun long day, I love it so much.
We've been here for over 12 hours.
So Falcon Punch now on her first scoring trip. And lots of lateral movement, not always effective because essentially the walls have just been filling up there, but both Falcon Punch and Space Invader, having a hard time getting out, but Space is out for 4 points out of the pack.
Gotham now in control of the pack. You see them knocking around Montreal so they can't put much defense together, giving Space Invader the time to fight up at the front now.
And that was some bendy magic happening there. But Free Shivakadu, sent to the penalty box, but I was just going to compliment the extraordinary one-on-one blocking that was taking place.
Just a little too far.
Yeah. And that's usually what happens as an announcer. You find yourself ready to give a shout-out, especially when in those one-on-one situations where you just take it too far in illegal contact.
An inch too far, yeah. An inch or a foot too far.
Yes.
Scores 116 for Gotham, 68 for Montreal. We're just at about 19 and a half minutes in the game. If a maneuverable and reactive plate is what you're looking for, then look no further than the Arius Platinum from Powerdyne. Arius Platinum, performance redefined.
I do want to draw quick attention to the penalties. Actually, we'll do that in just a moment. The next jam is underway. It is Kate Sarah up against Scartu Beachu, a matchup we saw plenty of times in the first half with Kate getting caught up more, but seems to have found her legs in this second half, able to pick up a lead once more in the second half, already coming back to collect points. Scartu just getting walled up into turn one. It's doesn't seem like a lot of movement, but there's so much happening in that pack. And it's a pack advantage once again for Gotham. A total of 23 penalties so far for Montreal in the game. Gotham with only 15. We'll address that in a moment, but Kate Sarah with another 4 points.
I was going to say that the differentials stayed pretty much the same when it comes to, I just put it in the forecaster, when it comes to ranking effects in this game so far. And that's going to be a call-off for Gotham. Total score on the jam is 12 for them, 128-68. We have 18 minutes left in this half so far. And we want to say thank you to Adam Skates, Antic Skates, Quick Bearings, Powerdyne, Radar Wheels, Rydell, and S1 Helmets. Thank you so much from WFTDA.
And we have an official review being called by Montreal. So we will get those details in just a moment. Our fantastic alt ref, Curse So Good, has been our eyes and ears out there. So, interesting tale about the penalties, though, Tober. I'm looking at this, and now we're seeing Montreal's picked up 23. Gotham has picked up 16. We've already had a foul out on Montreal as well. So what that is causing, of course, is massive pack advantage for Gotham in a game where every defensive player is going to be earning you points. That's a tough
one. The foul out does slow down the penalties for Montreal. They haven't picked up to match that since, you know. So you take the 7 out of 23, you get 16, so it'd be 16-16. So
yeah, that's
we
fair.
Could see it even out a little bit, but there has been some pack advantages in the second half that's made it harder for those Montreal Jammers, I think.
And I think, truthfully, obviously, you can't take it out of the picture because it is part of the picture, the first half.
You're right. You're totally right there.
Setting the pace. But I understand what you're saying. I think as a whole, as a team, the way that it has been spread, it's just an interesting part of the Derby story. Of course, it's never the whole story, just like the lead Jammer stats are never the whole story. How are those stats shaping up in the second half?
Yeah, so Smekta was his 80% lead because of the one where they took the no pass, no penalty and wasn't fully, and they have 49 points on the game. Right behind that is 40 points by Space Invader with 50% lead percentage. Smectivus has been out 10 jams. I mean, when you have a jammer that's that consistently picking up lead and points, not surprising. Space Invader has been out 6. Beauty Andy Beast has been out 6. And Kate Sarasara has been out 8. And then on the other side, you have Miracle Whips out 7, but only 12 points. Falcon Punch out 9, but with 20 points, which is the highest scoring for Montreal. And then Badger has 16 points, but 14 of those were in one jam.
Oh, yes. That is true.
Montreal will not retain their official review.
Okay, well, that time, sorry, we did actually have the official's mic. Our apologies if we
expected not to have it.
Yes.
So we will... I'll clarify again.
Cupcakes does have the info, and Tober will grab that in just a moment. If you're joining us, we are in the second half of the Montreal v. Gotham game. Montreal's second game of the day. They won against Dos por Cuatro earlier. Gotham's first appearance in champs. Well, on this day, rather, I should say.
Not ever.
The team that's been here since the very first champs consistently. All right, Tober will bring us that information in just a moment. The Smacktivist has already picked up lead jammer status in the time that we were finding out what was happening. Miracle Whips tries to catch up, and it is a one-point net there for Gotham.
Yeah, if you couldn't hear, they were looking, Montreal was looking for a blocking out of bounds on the Gotham jammer, and the jammer was not observed to be out of bounds, so they didn't get it. And the replay you just watched was the Smacktivist jumping over some feet and getting lead jammer.
Jumping over some feet.
And there's all the information that I've got for you.
These are all titles of Derby memoirs. If you want to take it, just copyright or credit Tober, Nella, whoever you want. It's in the common realm now.
Okay. Creative. Yeah. Everything we say is in the Creative Commons, apparently. I don't think the WTDA would like that.
Beauty Andy Beast with the star and lead for Gotham Badger. So now Gotham is just boom, boom, boom. Okay, after those lows last two jams, just shook everything up there.
You saw this in the last game when Philly played against Rose City, right? It was close and low scoring in the first half of the game, and then they were able to kind of open that up, and then the score was 205-50 at the end. I mean, I'm not predicting a score like that in this game. I'm not saying anything like that. But I am saying that, you know, maybe these teams that came in with a bye are a little less aggressive in the first half.
You have the opportunity to sort of feel things out and see how it goes. Of course, it's also your first time playing
on the floor.
On the track. So we are into jam 12. We have 16 minutes basically left in the game. Kate Sarasara with the star for Gotham. Falcon punch out for Montreal. And Kate Sarasara once again grabbing lead. This has been her most effective half for sure. The first one getting caught up. Obviously there must have been some adjustments in the locker room at halftime to account for that.
Well, I think Gotham in this second half is really kind of... It's going to be a power jam. It's a cut being called on Falcon Punch. I think Gotham's blocker core in this half has been knocking apart Montreal's walls a lot more effectively.
Okay, that was... Wow. I was listening to you, Tober.
I know, but then you got... I saw you got distracted. Why don't you tell me?
I got the glossy eyes. Kate Sarasara able to land the apex jump. Look at the blocker she was able to counter block while doing the jump and land in. Wow. I'm just... Wow. Okay, so into jam 12.
Basically, Montreal's having a hard time putting together those brace three walls where they can't lock the jammer in the sad place and therefore aren't able to slow down Gotham's scoring. So all of Gotham's jammers are scoring more and a lot and better because Gotham's blockers are just playing pinball in the past.
Yes,
breaking it up.
And Falcon Punch with a star stash, but... not enough to collect any points on that effort, and it was an effort because when you have the jammer penalties and then you come back and you're fighting, and I think we're going to see that moment there, the apex
there it
jump
is.
By Kate Sarasara.
What?
Well, so they both technically went out of bounds, but that was the moment I'm talking about, that fear stop, making sure, hey, what just happened? Oh, no, I'm good. We both went out, right? No earned pass. I'll take it and keep moving.
Like, oh, you're on the floor? Awesome.
Oh, we both went out? Okay. All right, Space Invader with the star for Gotham. Miracle Whip's jamming.
Oh, Miracle Whip just ran over.
Oh, but it doesn't matter because Miracle Whip's got lead. I saw a little bit of a shrug happening there.
Well,
oh,
she's...
my goodness. Miracle Whip's able to come in with a lot of speed and power, but does get the nudge out there by Violet Knockout.
Yeah, Gotham had four in a row before this, so Montreal able to break up that run here with lead.
But as we say that, a bit of a grind once more. The Gotham brace into turn at turn one. We have Montreal trying to spread things out, bridging. Space Invader, though, able to find a way, as Space Invader does.
Forces the call. 4 points for Montreal. 72 for them. Now 140 for Gotham. We have 13 minutes left in this half.
And we'll take another look at Miracle Whip's coming in with that speed, but getting tripped up a bit on that Gotham pivot.
Durable, functional, stable. The S1 Pro knee pads are built for roller derby.
That's why she had her hands up there. She was she thought she needed to exit the track. She didn't need to. She picked up lead. All right, into Jam 14, the Smacktivist with the star for Gotham. Not assessed. Oh, it was assessed a penalty. They are headed to the penalty box. That was a forearm call on the Smacktivist. Kaio Kenzie with the star for Montreal.
This is the second jammer penalty for the Smacktivist, but the first time they haven't been out of the pack first. Remember, the other time they didn't get lead was no pass, no penalty. They were out first. So this is the first time that they're giving an opportunity for another jammer to get out first, and that's going to be Kaio Kenzie, who's lead.
Kaio has to try to get out back. Oh, a big push out there by Gotham's Benita Applebaum.
That's a fun name. Fun person to watch.
Yeah, but Benita is sent to the penalty box. I didn't see the call there. Meanwhile, while Kaio has just picked up her first 4 points, we already have the Smacktivist back on the track, even playing a little defense.
It's a tiny pack, and no one's able to really find their friends, and so basically both jammers just kind of rocketing through as fast as they can.
And so now the jammers essentially chasing one another, but Caio deciding to call off the jam. It looks like, yeah, one of the skids blockers was freed just as the whistle blew, and there will be a timeout called by Gotham. There is 11 minutes, 27 seconds left on the clock of this game. Another look now at that starting point. There was the forearm call
that
had been assessed to the Smacktivist.
You kind of do see the follow-through with the forearm there causing the call. They're unsure, and they go to the box. And then the rest of the jam happened.
The rest of the jam happened. The total right now is Gotham with 140, Montreal with 80 points. It's been an intriguing second half in that we've seen jams that are very tight in time. Not as many drawn out as we kind of saw in the first half.
Yeah, I think that it's a little more physical. The one jammer's getting out with some time to score before the other one does. We're seeing a lot less double point scoring and some like lower scoring jams in general. And the score is 140 to 80. And then Falcon plates are a great option for a great plate price and includes a lifetime warranty. Check out Falcon plates.
And we'll see this familiar matchup of Scar to beat you taking on Kate Sarah. Sarah with the star for Gotham. And Misty Maven is here. In fact, I see her right now with my own eyes.
On her feet.
Running around. Gently running around the outside of the track. You know, there's lots of Misty Maven fans out there. Reminder, you are watching the 2019 Wftda International Championships. And in case you didn't know, it's the first time champs have been outside the U.S. We are in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Contrary to what some of the signage says. All right, so Scar2 beat you. Tries to take the outside line quick, but Dallas is not allowing that to happen. That's Roxy Dallas for Gotham. Just holding her back. Kate Sarasara has picked up lead. The pack hasn't really moved far from the jammer line. In fact, that's where Kate Sarasara is now connected with Montreal. Kate is really effective at squeezing the hips, trying to get past even if she can't physically pass. But Scar2 now has popped off the helmet cover from her head, looking for Alcatraz, her pivot. But that was big hit by Benita Applebaum, slowing things down. The pack is essentially just stuck in the mud as I say that. Kate Sarasara is freed with 4 points.
A little bit of a late bridge by Montreal. That's what frees Kate Sarasara in the front.
You're expending a lot of energy when you're trying to remember where all your markers are and to get there. And there's a lot of bridging happening in this game.
Kate Sarasara hit that pack and got through.
Ooh, and a nice little sneaky start pass. Sorry, Tober.
It's okay. You got real excited.
It was so sneaky. And that was to Alcatraz. And that does slow things down. A multiplayer penalty assessed as well. 2999. That's KT Kaboom. And we'll have another
replay. There's that sneaky. I knew it was going to come. There's that sneaky star pass. Just going to put my wrist out like this. And do you see it? I have the helmet cover. Do you see it?
And the Gotham block, the pivot was just like you could see watching like what is, oh, that just,
but
oh.
Yeah, they were so into, like, they had that beautiful braced two all whatever, but they were so engaged with each other that they couldn't disengage fast enough. It was so fast.
It is fast. You know, the slow-mo does not do it justice. We are now a nine and a half minutes left in the second half of the game. Jam 16, Beauty and the Beast, but the crowd is going crazy because it's Falcon Punch who has punched a ticket with lead jammer status there. And what will Montreal do with this control of the game? Mange is providing defense there at the back of the pack. That's in turn two. It's just a grind coming up against that Gotham wall, though. And Beauty and the Beast is no stranger to that slow and effective use of play. I was wondering what was going on. The crowd is telling us all this.
There's a direction of play penalty, it appears, called on Beauty and the Beast. This will be a power jam for Falcon Punch. She's going to call off the jam, freezing Beauty and the Beast in the penalty box. And we'll get restarted in a second. See if there's... I see points go up, but they haven't hit the board yet. Yep, 3 for Montreal. It's 83 to 150. 8.5 minutes left in this half. And Miracle Whips looks like she's on the line for this power jam. Good thing about a power start is you not only have control over who jams, you have control over your full pack as well, although you also give the other team control over who they put out.
That's the thing, right? And the other team is bracing for about 30 seconds of defense. So we'll see how Miracle Whips is able to get by. Gets by Roxy Dallas, gets by Violet Knockout, and Daryl. Wow. Miracle Whips picks up lead. Beauty Andy Beast is now standing in the penalty box. Meanwhile, Miracle Whips already coming back to pick up some points. Trying to take the outside, does not withstand Roxy Dallas there.
Gotham doing a great job of shutting the door. They'll leave a little tantalizing peek of that line on the outside or inside that Montreal loves to be on, and then they'll just slam it shut right as that jammer commits, wasting time.
Although right now, Beauty Andy Beast in the sad place, coming up against KT Kaboom and Monge.
Yeah, so is Miracle Whips in the back in the sad place.
Sorry, that was not Monge. That was a free Shavakadu.
Yeah, they got them realizing why we're in the back. Why are we bracing? Why are we bridging? They stop bridging.
Yeah.
And get their jammer almost all the way free. But no, it's a forearm penalty. It's going to lock Beauty Andy Beast in the penalty box. This is the fifth trip,
but this will be the third jam that Beauty Andy Beast will be involved in. And that can't feel good right now. Montreal once again able to freeze the jammer in there. We're going to see where that call came from, likely.
Yep, she had her arm pinned. So Beauty Andy Beast had her arm kind of pinned against her chest as she was being blocked.
Yeah, that was low rider.
Yeah, out. And then as she, you know, she's trying to not fall out. So she's doing that, like, backbend thing. And as she came up, she pushed her arm out away from her chest to get it free and instead got position on low rider and now is back in the penalty box.
Yeah, the matrix bend, I like to call it.
Yeah.
The problem really is out of this world.
The problem with that, though, is if your arms are pinned, you're so likely to push them forward because you're trying to throw your body weight forward to stop the fall, and you pick up those forearm penalties.
100%. And we have Badger out with the star for Montreal. It is now an effective penalty kill as Beauty Andy Beast has been released from the box. No lead assessed yet. Badger being drawn all the way back to the back of the pack, which is in the straightaway. Turn one is just a hot spot, I tell you.
There's heat maps up here.
Yes.
And I bet you it's just like between the jammer line and like turn two is just red. Mm-hmm. This is where the derby goes.
Yeah. This is where the derby has been happening. Nothing wrong with that. It is where our spectators are. We have a high block penalty assessed to one of the Gotham blockers. I'll check out her number in just a moment. It is Fast and Loose. And we have basically a standstill split pack a little bit.
You know what I'm noticing? Some activist has pivot helmet on right now.
Oh, very interesting.
Yeah, I haven't noticed that yet. I'm not sure if they've been doing that all game, but I just noticed it this time.
Well, might be a signal there to Beauty Andy Beast.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
To give Beauty up the ghost.
Yes. Yeah. I forgot. We're in a penalty spiral.
But look at that. Picks up lead because you know what? To heck with two penalty trips. I'll take a lead, thank you very much. And so the jam goes on.
Low block called, not on Beauty and the Beast, the jam's in command.
Wow, so Gotham is now up 154, Montreal 87. We have 4 minutes, 20 seconds left on the game clock. And this has been in a lot of ways, like we talked about, lots of quick jams, but also lots of grindy, difficult jams.
And these are not easy. Like, so every time these teams play each other, their scores are pretty low. Right? The last time they played, it was 201 to 111. Pretty much, recently, that's kind of been the area they've been in. You know, in the past, Gotham and blown them out 300, 400 points, but that's not currently what's going on. So, because these are both these teams are defense heavy and able to kind of hold the score low and tight. And
yeah.
We've seen a lot of that in the second half.
And playing a lot of very similar style.
Yeah.
Space Invader, by the way, picked up lead jammer status for Jam 19. and is already trying to score some points. Tries to call for some offense, but Kaio Kenzie, just the second she is out of that pack, good luck. Like, she's right back there.
You know, in an earlier interview, I believe there were two Montreal skaters that were saying that they also scrimmage each other quite a bit.
Ah, yes.
So that's, you know, they probably, their games are informed by each other as well from that.
Yeah,
pollinating of ideas back and forth.
Ooh, that's a really great way to put it. Because that is what happens, right? You pick and choose the good parts that you want to spread to the rest of your league and share with everyone. So we are in a timeout for Montreal. It's their second timeout usage.
3 minutes, 10 seconds left in the game. It's a good time to stop the clock for them. We're going to look at this replay.
Look at
showing Space Invader. When you said it earlier, Space Maker.
Space Maker, Space Creator, whatever.
Space Creator, that's what it was. Space Creator. That's what she did.
It's all of it. It's just, hey, I am going to make this path, make this lane.
If you've heard me talk about forecasting games or stats or live game updates, because I've been using stats.wftda.com, you can follow along with live game updates, matchups, and in matchups. You can also forecast game results, keep up with who's playing who when, and see how playoffs affect live rankings. So if you are a numbers nerd like me, you should have stats.wftda.com open on your computer, along with Twitter, which I'm sure you do if you're a dork like me.
And we did see a shot earlier just on the stream of Misty Maven. As we talked about, she has had a season with a lot of personal moments, meaning, like, I know that there was a surgery involved, so
she was very open about
very open on
how she felt
media
about that.
So just to see her here and her support, I do understand that a lot of fans of the game are also happy to see her here.
And she's sitting in turn three, and it looks like during timeout she's coming in, so I believe that would mean that she's in turn three in official capacity.
Yes, Kate Sarasara out first and picks up lead. I wasn't sure if that was an initial pass or a no-word pass there. Falcon Punch with a star for Montreal. The Montreal crowd, though, still super energetic in this, the final game of day one. It has been a phenomenal day one. I can't believe it's almost done. But this game is just delivering, and another one by Malge shutting down Kate Sarasara. You're not going to get that apex jump. I'm sorry, she says, closing the door. But Falcon Punch unable to get by either, now spilling out to the outside of turn one.
This two blocking up at the front of the pack we saw a lot of in Montreal's first game today,
yes,
against Dos Por Cuatro. Not so much in this game. When they're able to put it together, it's both beautiful to watch and incredibly effective. And they used it to recycle Kate Sarasara, but she eventually gets out, and that's four more on the board.
Yeah, they were catching Kate earlier in the game with their three wall, which was super effective, right? We're seeing that old school brace just lock down both teams. So clearly, Kate adjusted at the half, and Montreal went, okay, now time to see how we can adapt. But this has been a grinded out gem. Falcon Punch has not completed her initial, just did. Incredible effort there. That is no easy task. I am in no way making light of the hard work that's going on out there. It might be minus whatever degrees outside, but it must be scorching out there on the track.
It's not minus, it's just 20. You come
in
from somewhere
Fahrenheit.
Cold. Oh yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
I don't understand your numbers.
There we see.
It's a beautiful. It's late. We're punchy,
it's really
over here.
Not that funny, but I just love that you felt the need to correct my Canadianisms.
No, okay. I realize now. I'm like, oh yeah, there's more than one temperature.
The Smagnum is out with lead here in Jam 21 of this incredible Game 6. And the crowd is loving the fact that Miracle Whips is out on our initial coming to pick up points. Smagnum is called it off.
Oops.
Oh, wasn't sure if she wanted, or if they wanted to, rather. My apologies.
I don't think that they realized what the time was on the clock. There was 24 seconds. The bench was like, we're going to put out Smactivist. Smactivist always gets lead. Smactivist gets lead, runs out the clock, calls out the game. The game is over. Smactivist is like, I get lead. I get points. I call it off before the other jammer gets. Oh, oops.
I do want to.
See, that's. Oh, oh,
Can't take it back. You can't take it back once you do it.
I do want to say I'm very sorry for accidentally misgendering Smacktivist there. I just need to say that. It was definitely unintentional, but still problematic. So I apologize for that. Space Invader with the star for Gotham. And we have Kaio Kenzie out there with the star for Montreal, the captain of Montreal. A timeout as well for the hometown crowd, because you just want to keep everyone on the edge of their seats that much longer.
Yeah, you get the timeout when you get the call off. Score is 170 to 87, 24 seconds left in this game. Courtesy of the Smacktivist accidental call off.
And the whistle blows. We have 24 minutes on the, or minutes, sorry, seconds on the game clock. This will likely be the last jam. Space Invader taking a big jump to try to get through and get lead. Kaio is laterally moving back, well, not back and forth, side to side rather, trying to brush off those Gotham. And the crowd is going to be happy with that finish there. And Kaio as well with a big smile, grabbing lead in that final jam of the game. While Space Invader is being held back by Alcatraz, Magnum PEI has been doing phenomenal blocking work for the Skids all game, quietly holding down the fort. Space Invader still unable to get by that Montreal line, now finally through on her initial as Kaio is dancing side to side and decides, I'm going to call it off. I feel good shutting out Gotham in that last jam. Gotham does take this win.
The unofficial final is 170 to 90. That's an 80-point differential. The last time these two teams played, it was 201 to 111. That's a 90-point differential. So 10 points better this time for Montreal.
And here we have another look at Kaio getting past Benita Applebaum. Wow. And the crowd, which you can't see in that shot, was just so pumped up by it. And we can't thank the crowd in the venue enough. We also can't thank the people out there watching enough for their support and for joining us on this, the first day of the 2019 WFTDA International Championships in Montreal. And we got to talk about what happens next, because some exciting things now for Gotham and really for Montreal as well.
So Gotham goes on to play VRDL tomorrow at 6 p.m. in Game 9. That will be for a shot, a continued shot at the Hydra. Both teams still in the running. Montreal no longer in the running for the Hydra, but gets a consolation game on Sunday at noon against Philly. That should be a fun game to watch, and the home crowd is probably excited
so what
to
you're
see
telling
them again.
Me is that the Skids get to have a day off.
They do.
In their hometown. You know what? An interesting thing as well. The Skids were able to really focus on their champs run because Montreal Roller Derby has taken care of hosting this event and not relying on the Skids to provide any additional like hours in the day, which is incredible.
What's we have a London Bridge going on.
Very nice.
This is delightful. I have to say.
That's how many people there are. It's going around the entire track. Oh my gosh, it's a great show.
If you've never watched roller derby in Montreal, you should do that someday. They build pyramids out of beer cans. They make London Bridges. There was somebody dressed as a sexy carrot earlier. It's just,
that carrot was amazing.
I know, I cannot explain to you the fun and excitement that has been here. What a great host city, what great hosts Montreal Roller Derby has been. And also, they played two amazing games today. Two games in one day.
Big games. Their first against 2x4. Let's just remind everybody what's on tap. First thing, when you tune in tomorrow, all times Eastern, just keep that in mind, at 11 a.m., there will be a special introduction to the incredible Derby Without Borders game. That is Jewish Roller Derby up against Team Indigenous Rising. It is going to be a spectacular game, and that special intro is going to be amazing. It all starts at 11. The game actually starts at 11:30. Then we go into our first consolation game at 1:30, which is Texas taking on 2x4. At 3:30, we have our second consolation game, Denver versus Angel City. And then at 6 o'clock, you're going to see Da-da-da! Gotham taking on VRDL. Of course, that is a semi. They are, or no, a quarterfinal.
Yeah, I think it's quarterfinal, right?
No, that's a semi. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, you're right.
So what happens?
We're good at brackets. We're great at brackets.
We know how to bracket. Okay.
We can totally bracket. Anyway, it's at 6 p.m., and both of them are still eligible for the Hydra, is what we're trying to say.
That's what we're saying. There's a lot on the line. And then the final game of tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, that is going to be your arch-rival, the Rose City game. And just considering how tight that arch-rival Denver game was, 127-122, it's going to be interesting to see what they bring tomorrow.
They're hungry, though. That was an intense game. Both Denver and Arch showed up ready to go, and then the score was 127-122.
Well, we want to thank you for joining us. I do believe that we will be...
There will be a sideline interview, but we're not quite ready yet.
And that's so, okay, because we have more to tell you about.
Yeah, do you know that the Wftda has released their organizational code of conduct and have created a code of conduct toolkit for the community? The toolkit is meant to help you understand the concepts and values behind the new Wftda organizational code of conduct and help your league create their own. You can find this and more tools for anyone in Derby at resources.wftda.org. Because culture can direct the thoughts and action of group members over the long term, and this will help your league navigate those cultural shifts. So you can check that out at resources.wftda.org. It's a wonderful thing out there for the community, and you should share it with your leagues if you haven't seen it already. And I can't say enough about how amazing the code of conduct is.
I'm enjoying the I'm enjoying the post-game photo shoot. I do believe we have a Gotham skater with our fantastic rich mahogany. That is Roxy Dallas. I'm not sure they're quite 100% ready, so we will...
We're reading body language here, and it does not look like 100% ready.
Oh, I'm so glad to see what day two is going to bring, though, Tober, because if the energy on day one is indicative of what's going to happen on a Saturday night in Montreal, come on!
Well, especially considering that, you know, tomorrow is really where we set the stage for the big game.
The big game.
Not the Super Bowl.
Every game is big.
But the big game. Well, I know.
Yeah.
Every game is big. The one game ends with a trophy.
Yes. True. Touche. I mean, two others end with medals. So we do want to say a big thank you to Chloroform Cupcake. Thank you to October Revolution. I'm Death Nella. We're going to throw it on over to Rich Mahogany.
I'm Rich Mahogany. I'm here with Roxy right after Gotham's game up against Montreal, of course, the hosts of this tournament. Nice win here for Gotham. Congratulations.
Thank you.
With this, you're going to be heading on to play VRDL tomorrow at 6 p.m. for an opportunity to go to the gold medal game. How you feeling after that?
Feeling great. We accomplished our goals. We did what we set out to. We made some commitments to each other, and we saw them through, and that's what we're proud of.
That's great, you guys. So one thing that I noticed in that game is you all did a really, really good job of shutting down the Montreal Jammers. Mm-hmm. Was there something that you've been practicing for particularly that felt really helped you there?
Our Jammers are amazing. We get to practice against them week in, week out. We happen to know Montreal pretty well. Our neighbors to the north, we get to see them a lot. So, we have some familiarity with their style. They're always really hard to deal with, but we have a little bit of an idea of what to expect. So we're able to talk to each other about that and plan for it.
Great. Well, so you've got the evening now to kind of rest and recuperate. Yes. Do you have any big plans for tonight, or is it pretty much just head back to the hotel and chill out?
No big plans, no big party, probably a lot of Law & Order SVU.
All right. Well, is there any food in the area that maybe you're going to be checking out once the tournament's wrapped up?
You come to Montreal, you have to eat bagels, and you eat like 10 of those in a sitting, as you do. So it equals one New York bagel, and that feels nice. That feels right.
Oh, awesome. Well, I think that'll about do it for our time here. Thank you so much, and thank you all for tuning in. That'll do it for our day here at day one of the 2019 Wftda International Championships here in Montreal. Tune in bright and early at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time tomorrow for our first game of the day. It'll be our nation's game, seeing Team Indigenous taking on Team Jewish Roller Derby. So, for the Wftda, thank you very much. I've been Rich Mahogany. We will see you tomorrow.